Cool. Hello, everybody. Today we are going to talk about Git-driven debugging, and I'm going to ask for like a little bit of audience interaction because that makes me feel more relaxed. So I have a question for y'all, and you don't have to yell it out. I'm going to let y'all do like indicators. What is your favorite method for debugging? And I'm going to give you two choices. Do you prefer using the debugger, or do you prefer using print statements? If you prefer using the debugger, do like a heart hand. All right, we got a couple. Cool, cool, cool. All right, see one over there and over there. All right, and then for people who like using print statements, do this. Yeah. All right, cool. All right, I'll tell y'all what my favorite is. I mean, maybe nobody cares, but I'm gonna share it anyways. So I prefer print statements. 20% because I'm a little bit lazy as a developer, but the other 80% is I don't think debuggers like me. I swear it doesn't matter what company or project I'm working in, my debugger's always broken, and then I have to like edit the launch.json file, and then I feel like I'm just debugging my debugger so I could debug my code, and it feels really inefficient. However, I do like see the value of it. When I'm dealing with like race condition issues or state management issues, so it has been helpful there. But we're not really here to talk about like print statements versus the debugger. I'm actually here to introduce you or reintroduce you to a faster way to identify and resolve regressions using Git. I thought I was going to be like the first person to talk about that at this conference, but I've heard like more than one person talk about this already, so. But it's called Git Bisect, and we're going to go into it a little bit deeper. But first, I'm going to introduce myself to y'all, because you're probably like, who's this amazing person on the stage? So my name is Rizel. I'm a junior developer advocate at GitHub. Prior to working at GitHub, I was a software engineer for about 3 years. I'm currently an advisor, and I was a director at G-Codehouse, which is an organization that teaches women of color and non-binary people of color about web development. I'm pretty passionate about like empowering and educating people about tech, but I'm also passionate about using social media. Some might say I'm like a little addicted to Twitter, but you know. So if you also use social media, you can go ahead and follow me at Black Girl Bytes. That's my handle on Twitter, on Hashnode and dev.2. I write a lot of blog posts on GitHub, on Instagram, YouTube, whatever. But on Twitch, I'm BlackGirlBytes1 because I forgot my password and got myself locked out of my account. So I only have a little bit of time here, so this is the agenda. We're going to talk about how I discovered Git Bisect, what it is, and how to use it, and then I will wrap up. So I discovered it while working at a startup. This startup was a little bit toxic, but I will give it to the startup. I learned so many things, like that a junior engineer probably wouldn't be getting a lot of experience with. I learned about like DynamoDB and CloudWatch and CloudFormation and Twilio, and I learned a lot about Git. And prior to that startup, I really was kind of scared of Git and GitHub. So I went to coding bootcamp. I attended a coding bootcamp. And I was very confused by all of it. So I was like, I'm just going to memorize these four commands, and hopefully that will get me through life. I was like, all I need to know is git init, git add, git commit, git push. I didn't even know how to do pull requests. Instead of like doing a pull request, I would just delete the whole repo, edit it locally, and then push it back up because I was scared to break something. But after that boot camp, I went to internship, and we were using Mercurial. So I forgot everything about Git. But then I started at this startup, and I met my coworker called the Gitator. You would think it's like I'm bullying him or something, but he liked that name. Like, that was a name that he coined for himself. And he saw that our team, our company, was not using a great Git workflow, so he really got us together. He taught me how to rebase. He would sit down with me every time I needed to rebase and start yelling at me. He's like, no, don't do that. Do this. I'm like, OK, got you. And then he also introduced me to Git Bisect. And you're probably like, you keep talking about Git Bisect. What is it? So Git Bisect, to me, is one of the secret ways to faster debugging. The way it works is it's powered by a binary search algorithm, and it searches through your project's commit history to identify when a bug was first introduced. So what it needs from you is for you to give it a good commit or a moment in time when the bug wasn't present, and then a bad commit on a moment in time when you did see the bug. And what it'll do is it'll go through those that range you gave it, and it'll find when it was initially introduced. But please note, for it to work well, you do have to have a linear commit history, because if not, that doesn't really reflect the true changes that were made in your code, and it can get Git bisect a little bit confused. So you might be thinking, why would I need Git to go through my commit history? I can do that myself. I can do it manually. But if you think about it, why not expend way less brain power finding the bug and spend more brain power actually fixing it? Also, if you have a project where there's like a large number of commits, doing a linear search can take forever, right? Like just imagine going one by one by one. That's like a lot of work. But what Git bisect is doing, it's using a binary search algorithm. So basically, it's going to reduce the number of revisions that are potentially bad by half. So, oh, I forgot about this slide. But basically, this is a GIF. If people are not familiar with a binary search algorithm, the top half of the GIF shows that a binary search algorithm can find the number 37 in like 3 steps. Whereas in a sequential or linear search, when you're going one by one by one, it takes about 11 steps. So there you can see like the how much more efficient it is. And then here's like a little visualization of how Git bisect will work. It's like you'll give it your good commit and the bad commit, and it'll go through each of them and be like, is this one the bad commit? And you'll be like, not really. And then it'll take off all the ones in between and ignore those, and then it'll try to identify the other ones it hasn't checked. So that might not have made sense. So I made a demo. And I'm not going to do it live. I have a video because the demo gods are never with me. So let's just go with this video. All right. So before I start it, because I move really fast in this video, is I'm going to open up my repository in GitHub Codespaces. If people don't know what GitHub Codespaces is, it allows you to use Visual Studio Code in your browser. It also comes with a terminal. It's not the same thing as when you press dot in your repo. Everybody gets confused with that. That's like GitHub's web editor. But basically, I'm going to press it. And I'm showing y'all. But the cool thing, too, is that when I loaded up this code space, I got it to have everything I wanted, including extensions. Because I use this repository to teach people front-end web development, and I want them to have all the extensions necessary. So I'm just showing you that I made a devcontainer.json to make sure my dev environment was right, and ESLint is already installed along with the other extensions. But look at the bug in this video. Let me pause it really quickly. But the bug is this clock is moving like irrationally fast. And I'm like, I don't know why. When did I mess this up? So what I'm going to do is use git bisect to help me out. And I'm going to type git bisect start. So I'm typing git bisect start. And then what it's going to do is ask me for good commits and bad commits. So I'm going to look through my git log. And I'm like, the bug is present in this current commit I see, so I'm just going to take the most recent one. So I type git bisect bad, and I paste in that commit hash. And then for the good commit, I'm going to look through my git log again. And I'm like, I don't remember it existing when I added a red background. So I go ahead and do git bisect good, and I paste that actual commit hash in there. And then it gives me, let me pause it real quick. It gives me a commit hash that it possibly could have been introduced in. So I'm going to go ahead and check that one out. And I think in this video, I realized I didn't need to copy the whole long like hash. I just needed the first couple numbers. So I'm going to go back to my editor and copy the right part. And then I'm going to go to it. And womp, womp, womp. This is definitely not where the bug was introduced. Let me, I wish I could rewind it just a little bit. It's not where the bug was introduced because this is just some HTML that I changed. So I'm going to go back to git bisect and tell it, nah, that's a bad commit. So I'm going back and I go git bisect bad, and it suggests another one for me. And it says, we have no other choices. Like, there's roughly 0 steps left. This has to be it. So I go ahead and I copy that commit hash, and hopefully this is it. So we're going to see. I look through my commit history again. I find that hash. And that is definitely it, because for some reason I changed the word hour to second, so now my hour hand is moving as fast as my second hand. So what I'm going to do is go back to my code in my script.javascript file and change that to say hour instead of seconds. And now my clock is moving like a normal clock. Cool. So going back to this, and we're basically wrapping up, is, I am super excited. I just want to end with saying I'm super excited for the direction that developer tools are going in to make debugging easier. There's projects like Replay.io that enables us to have a time travel debugger, and all these other things that make developing easier. Every time I listen to somebody talk about, like, when they were coding back in the day, like, I was listening to Martin the other day saying, like, oh, he used to, what was it he used to do? Print out the Git revisions? That sounded crazy. Or like the version control and highlight it? That's really wild that happened. But I'm super excited to see this landscape grow and make things a little bit easier for us. That's all I have. Thank you, everyone.